Hello and welcome. I hope you're doing well. Come and get cozy as I share with you some absolutely terrifying encounters. I post new videos every day, so be sure to hit that subscribe button and the notification bell, and you'll be notified when new daily content arrives on my channel. All right, let's get right into it. New York in Sumter County in Alabama. In November, I was a young 13-year-old deer hunter. It was probably one of the first times that I was ever allowed to sit in a tree stand by myself. I had been in a tree stand approximately 2 miles from my father and brother and about 1.5 miles from our cabin. The man who owned the property had told me to wait until dark and follow the dirt road right back to the cabin. I hadn't seen any deer all day. So, at nightfall, I unloaded my rifle and started the walk back. After I had walked about 150 yards from the green field, I heard something moving in the woods. I thought to myself that now was a fine time for the deer to come back into the field. As I walked, I noticed that the sound seemed to be following me. I took my spotlight and shined it in the trees, but couldn't see anything. This didn't surprise me, since I was deep in the Alabama woods. After a little longer, I caught a strong odor and the steps seemed to be moving faster. I walked faster, so did the sound. All of a sudden, I felt this thing close in. I shined my flashlight and something seemed to snort and jump across the field in front of me and run through the woods on the other side. I dropped my flashlight and tried to fire my rifle. In my panicked young mind, I had forgotten that I had unloaded it. When I realized my mistake, I turned and ran all the way to the cabin. Only when I got back did I remember that I had left my flashlight in the middle of the road. Luckily, my dad had killed a deer, so I had time to calm down before he got back to the cabin. I told him I had dropped my light, and the next day we went to get it, and it was gone. I didn't tell him what really had happened. As I got older and learned the sounds of the woods, I came to realize that what I had heard on that November night was not walking on four legs, rather, it was on two. I have never spoken of that event again until this year. I told my wife about it after 14 years of marriage. As I told her about it, I got chills, much the same as I am experiencing as I'm writing this. Since that time, I have killed many, many deer, but I have never gone into the woods until daylight and have never stayed till dark again. I was alone on the road. It was dark, but I could smell it. I thought at first I smelled a deer. As it closed in, it sounded like a freight train snorting at me. It was more of a dark shape, jumping or maybe stepping quickly in front of me. It definitely had a human shape, but it was huge. I only saw it for a quick second in front of me, maybe 10 to 15 feet away. The thing looked like a dark human shape and it passed right in front of me. Then I could hear it moving away from me in the woods as I took off the other way. There was a moon out, but if you've ever been on an Alabama dirt road at night, you know that all you could do was see it. It snorted and grunted as it went by me. It wasn't making human sounds. Now, I will tell you that I'm not a scary person. I'm a bodybuilder. I played college football and am still considered somewhat of a celebrity in my hometown. I have thought about this night every time I've gone into the woods to camp or hunt. I work on the weekends as a bouncer in a huge Latin nightclub. I have a professional job throughout the week. I had no interest of ever telling anyone this story. One Saturday night, about a month ago, I had gotten off work at the club and had gotten home at about 4 a.m. On the way home, I was listening to the radio and they were talking about Bigfoot sightings and such. They had a guest on who had a recording of what he called the sounds of Bigfoot. The sounds scared the life out of me and brought back all of these memories. This morning, I was getting some food out of the fridge. My wife never wakes up when I get home.
On this particular morning, she did. I was just closing the door when she said, "Hello," kind of quiet-like. I jumped, and it scared me so bad I dropped my eggs, the milk, and I yelled. When I turned around, she thought I was having a heart attack. I fell to the floor and was white as a ghost. She came to me, and I was breathing irregularly. When I finally calmed down, she coaxed out of me what was wrong. I told her the whole story and swore her to secrecy. The same witness as the previous sighting in Russell County had their second encounter. My girlfriend and I were driving back from our senior prom, Georgia, Chattahoochee River border area. Our high school was 37 miles down the river, way out on the boondocks. Anyway, as we were driving back home, we came to a flat, two-mile section of the road that had a slippery when wet sign. Because we were tired and sober with road hypnosis, the sign reflection caught our attention, she told me after. As we came closer to the sign, something moved or reflected as we came closer, getting our attention. About 100 feet away, with our lights fully shining onto it, we saw this massive black creature leaning on the sign. The top of the sign, I guess to be about 10 feet tall. Whatever this creature was, all we could see was the top of the chest and down, about 10 feet of the creature. We couldn't see the head. It just stood there. We could see the massive muscles, in most in rippling detail, shiny black fur, standing with intelligence, if you can understand that term. We sped up all the while, screaming at each other, scared to death. A mile down the road, my left rear tire blew out. I drove 7 miles to the first house with a light and called my father to come help us. While at this house, we talked with a few of the people that were there. They were having a party. We were told a couple of stories about a missing hunter, animals found gutted or with their heads missing, a lot of strange screams in the night. Firstly, I must say beyond a shadow of a doubt that this was no hoax. The costume alone would have cost thousands and thousands of dollars to create. Second, the people that live in the area are extremely poor. As a matter of fact, the home we drove up to after our tire blew out had light seeping through the cracks in the siding of the house. While it sat on cinder blocks after my tire blew and we drove to the first house with a light to call my father for help, the people in the house were having a party. They told us it was common to hear strange screams, strange sounds, and missing pets. The area around the sighting is flat and swampy. Off to the right, about 500 feet, is a very woodsy, swampy area. On to the next one. During the fall in Escambria County in Alabama, I was riding my bicycle down a wooded trail in a relatively populated part of town. A Bigfoot jumped out in front of me. I fell off my bike and he stood over me and howled and growled not feet away from me. He then turned and ran through the woods away from me. He was between 7 and 8 feet tall, more on the skinny side, but still big. Not groomed, but kind of mangy looking. Longer than average arms and thick through the shoulders to the top of the neck. I know what I saw. I'm 42 now and have been called crazy all my life because I openly admit what I saw. The sound it made could not be recreated by a person. A grocery store dumpster containing old food was close to where the encounter occurred. Days later, I heard of sightings between Castleberry and Evergreen. On to the next one. Bigfoot appeared in Brea, Kentucky in the early 1970s. It was about 1972 or 73 in Brea, Kentucky, said one witness, and I must have been 15 or so. My brother, a friend of mine, and I were sleeping out in our tent made of plastic tossed over one of those umbrella-type clotheslines. The plan was to sneak out later to walk uptown to meet with our girlfriends. It was probably about 2 a.m. when I came out of the tent. Our house was built into a hillside and overlooked the college-owned cornfield and out across the country, which at the time was not very developed. I was standing with my back to the field, looking up the hill at the stars while waiting for the others to get up. I got impatient and had turned around toward the tent to tell them to hurry when I saw what I first thought was my neighbor standing at the corner of the house, standing next to the pine tree that grew there. Problem was, this thing looked to be about 7 or 8 feet tall, and as its head was into the branches. My mind was racing, trying to grasp or rationalize what I was seeing. Why was my neighbor wearing white? How did he know we were out here tonight? Why was he standing so still, and how the heck did he get so tall? We, meaning it and I, stared at each other for several seconds. Then the thing turned and pushed off against the tree and bolted down over the bank and into the woods toward the cornfield. I was impressed with the speed, the lack of noise it made while running, and the fact that the tree, which was pretty big, actually swayed when it pushed off from it. About that time, my friend came out of the tent and I told him about what I had just seen. I don't remember if he acted like he believed me or not. My brother was more inclined to believe my story because he and my sister had often heard what we called the cruncher while sleeping out on the screened-in back porch, which is about 15 feet off the ground on the back of the house. Back before we had air conditioning, we three kids would sleep on the porch during the summer to get the cooler night air. We had a small mutt dog that would sleep with us. Many times, we would wake up to the sounds of, at least to our young imaginations, of an animal munching on bones. We were scared to death, but would look over the edge trying to see whatever it was. We never did see anything because the woods were so thick and we were so far up. We knew we weren't crazy because the dogs would sit there stock still and give one of those low, throaty growls that would make a person freeze if you heard it in the dark. We tried a couple of times to get the dogs to go outside, and we were hoping to chase the thing. We never saw a dog resist so hard. She acted like we were trying to shove her into a fire or something. After that dog died, we got another that reacted the very same way and was only about half as smart as the little mutt dog. My dad had floodlights installed, which only succeeded in lighting up the wall of trees and vegetation. The witness remembers that the thing was covered with off-white to tan-colored hair, with less on its face and stomach area. He could not recall any facial details, but remembers that its arm appeared to be longer than a human. My brother and sister can verify the cruncher, he said. We also built a playhouse in the backyard, which we only slept in one time, and that was on Halloween, with several other kids. We once went into the cornfield and picked so much corn that we had to leave it piled up in the thicket with the idea to get the rest the next day. Problem was, the next morning, it was gone. Every last ear. Way too much for a raccoon or even a family of raccoons to have hauled off. I should add that this was what we called field corn, which became rock hard when ripe and was used to feed cows and pigs. If you caught it at the right time, it was pretty good to eat. Otherwise, it would crack your teeth. It finally hit me a few years later that the cruncher was probably eating the field corn and not munching on bones. After a while, the area started to get built up and we heard less and less of the noise. There was an article in the local paper about the time all this was happening, about a family that lived further out, but not that far from us, that had some unusual stuff happening around their home. They were finding what they thought were big nests of leaves around their property and had caught glimpses of something on occasion passing their windows. I still have that article somewhere. I wanted to contact the family, but never did. I was afraid of being called a nut because I live in a small town. I've only told a few people of this. It still raises the hair on the back of my neck to tell it and, as I just discovered, to write it down. This is the only event of my life that is unexplained. Our next Madison County stop is at Flint Road in Waco, Kentucky. In September of 1983, it was late afternoon on a beautiful fall day, and a Bigfoot was about to appear to a 12-year-old boy. The incident occurred in the later part of 1983, September, I believe, just outside of Richmond, Kentucky, in Waco. Said the witness, I was about 12 years old and was out riding my bike when I decided to go visit a friend. He lived about a quarter of a mile off the main highway at the end of a gravel road. His house was the only one on the road and was completely surrounded by thick woods. After arriving, I walked to the door and realized nobody was home. As I returned to my bike, I heard a loud crash from the side of the house. I quickly looked and saw a large black figure tearing a huge tree limb from a tree. The figure was at least 7 to 8 feet tall and covered in thick black hair. I couldn't guess the weight, but it was big. The figure was standing upright and was looking right at me. It was no bear. I quickly jumped on my bike and pedaled like heck toward the main road. The ride back to the main road seemed to take forever, and the entire distance back I could hear branches breaking and what appeared to be heavy footsteps running alongside me. I was terrified. I thought for sure I was about to be attacked. Then I hit the main road and stopped. I kept riding, but couldn't help but wonder why whatever it was stopped chasing me once I hit the road. I don't know what it was, but I do know if it were a bear, it wouldn't have stopped. And it was fast because it was able to catch a terrified kid pedaling his butt off. I had another encounter in the same area when I was 19. He saw a Bigfoot that was at a distance of about 50 yards away. The sighting only lasted a few seconds, but he was able to add that the thing appeared to be slightly pigeon-toed. It stood and moved upright and had a thick, muscular body covered with shiny white fur. Another such creature, this one covered with thick, reddish-colored hair, was seen in the Bear Mountain area in the summer of 1993. It was July of 93. I was hiking up on Bear Mountain near my family's home in eastern Kentucky. I had my pair of binoculars I had just bought and wanted to try them out on a high view. As I rounded the cliff, I was looking down this hollow that leads into a briar thicket. I had been hearing this odd tapping noise all the while and saw this dark brownish figure near a log close to the thicket some 250 yards away, more or less. At first, I thought it a rare sighting of a black bear, but when I looked at it through the binoculars, I couldn't believe what I saw. It was sitting on a log with its back to me, with a rock in its hand, beating on this log's side. It had a back that was at least 2.5 feet across and covered in short, thick, reddish-brown hair. It looked like a giant, hair-covered man with no neck. I could see it in good detail, so there was no mistake. The hands looked human, 4 fingers and a thumb. The skin a dark grayish color. The head was conical like a gorilla. Suddenly, this thing must have smelled or sensed me, because it stood up and looked in my direction. It had a bulged forehead near the eyebrow, large round dark eyes, and a flared gorilla-like nose. The jaw was slightly long to the chest, but did not protrude at the mouth. The nose and eyes area were free of hair, the skin a dark gray, but from the nose, mouth, and chin were covered in hair. The creature was huge. I later looked at a tree it was standing near, and it had to be near 7 feet tall. It stared up the mountain at me and made a peculiar motion with its head, waving it from side to side, and it seemed to hunch over a bit with its arms dangling at its knees. It then turned and dashed off through the thicket. I never saw it again. Needless to say, I got the heck out of there. A dark-colored humanoid creature that stood 10 feet tall and had glowing red eyes allegedly scared a group of 8 Boonesboro, Kentucky youth in July of 2006. The group of 8 was night fishing in a local creek at about 1:30 a.m. when they heard something large coming up the creek in their direction. Breathing really hard and loud, Travis stated that within seconds after the group had heard the sound, a terrible odor, which smelled worse than a dead skunk, had permeated the area, and they decided to flee. According to him, they soon regained their courage and returned to the area and found a very large, unmistakably human footprint in the mud. They shined one of their flashlights at the nearby small bridge and observed the huge figure standing beneath the structure. Once again, and for good this time, they decided to leave the area. The incident, I am sure, curtailed any further nighttime fishing trips in the area.
I hope you enjoyed those encounters. And if you did, be sure to hit that like button, leave a comment, and subscribe. I post new content every single day, so be sure to hit that notification bell, and you'll be notified exactly when that new content arrives on my channel. Again, thank you so much, and until next time, bye!